We're grateful to have you here, and man, it is a beautiful day for worship, and we've got a great service planned. And can I just say this real quick? 2024 looks good on y'all. I'm just saying. Yeah, y'all look fresh and renewed. Yeah, that's very good. So anyway, we thank you for joining us. Thank you for being here in worship. If you're new with us and you want to connect, visit with any one of us, Pastor Mike, Denise, or myself after worship. We'd love to connect with you. One of the things we really believe in is the power of prayer. So continue to share your prayer requests however you can. Maybe you need prayer support for a new challenge or something you're doing. I know I need that. So whatever you need, please continue to share that in prayer, and we'll lift that up. This week, we have many, many opportunities to serve and be the church. One of those includes our regular ministries, so our student ministry tonight at 6, 6:30. When do you guys start? I mean, they're kids. They show up whenever, right? It's 6:30. Yeah, okay. That's the official start time, Mom and Dad. And then children's ministry is back on. Choir rehearsals are this week, all sorts of things. Wednesday night supper, we're going to have nachos. It's just great to be back in the rhythm. This week also, we are going to be starting our sermon-based, message-based small groups. There's several of those that meet regularly, and where we're starting a new series, this is a great chance to try it out. It'll only be for about 6 weeks for this series, so if you're interested, let us know. And then the other small group, a few small groups starting this month I wanted to lift up. The Man Code, Pastor Mike's leading tomorrow night. That's for men only at 7. Just show up at the church, even if you didn't pre-register. That'll be a great one. Financial Peace is starting at the end of the month. And then we have, what on earth am I here for? That's a great question, isn't it? What on earth are we here for? Well, we're going to take a look at one of the best-selling books, at least in Christian history. It actually, the only book that's ever outsold it, as far as Christian books are read, is the actual Bible. So it's The Purpose-Driven Life by Pastor Rick Warren. And just a six-week series where we'll ask that question, kind of cover some of the basics, and enjoy some really good conversation. So that'll be at the end of the month as well. Lots and lots going on. Today we start a new message series called Starting Over. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I need reminded to start over and that it's okay to get up and get going. So I already talked about the message-based small groups that are doing with that. We're going to talk about that stuff more in worship here. Real quick, I know, there's just a lot going on. It's the new year. Y'all in the routine? We have preschool brochures on the back. Just as a reminder that our 2024-2025 school year registration is already open, and early bird registration is half off. So if you know somebody who'd like to be in preschool or you'd like to have them connect, we have these brochures, very informative, on the back tables today in worship. Lastly, I'm going to share a little God sighting because Denise's is really good. And I feel like I got to measure up to her. Denise does better than I do most of the time. We have an amazing ministry where we feed the hungry here in North Platte. And over the last few months, for whatever reason, busy schedules or whatever, it was getting harder to find volunteers to do that. And the last time we served at the Salvation Army, not the last time, last year, in December, when we served at the Salvation Army, we only had like two or three servers, and you need at least five to serve that community. Well, we put that out in our communication, and the church rose to the challenge. We had a dozen people show up to serve, which was such a blessing. One of the comments that was made was actually from one who was being served. It was nice to be able to visit with someone. Not just be served, not just to stand on the other side of the counter, but to have enough people to actually talk and communicate with one another. So we're so grateful for that. Last announcement, next week, chicken noodle dinner Sunday. Confirmation class is going to serve us, and we're excited for that. That's enough of announcements. I can tell you all are ready. Let's stand and join our voices together in our call to celebration.
Well, we are so thankful for everyone that's able to join us, both in person and online. Thanks for joining us. I'm Pastor Mike, and we're going to go through our call to celebration, responsive reading that comes from Psalm 146. I'll have you follow along on the screens. Praise the Lord, O my soul.
I will praise God all my life.
Do not put your trust in mortals. But happy are those whose help is in God.
Creator of heaven and earth.
God who executes justice for the oppressed.
Who gives food to the hungry.
The Lord sets the prisoners free.
And opens the eyes of the blind.
Our God lifts up the humble.
For the Lord loves the righteous.
Amen. Our opening song this morning is God of Love and God of Power. It's number 578 in the hymnal. Words are also on the screen.
Seated. Come on, children, it's your time.
Invite any of the kids forward for our children's time. You can come on up here and have a seat with us. How are you guys doing? You guys having a good new year?
Yeah.
Well, one of my favorite things over Christmas break is I get to play a bunch of games with my family. Do you guys like to play games?
Yeah.
What's a favorite game you guys have?
Cards.
Cards? Just any kind of cards? What's your favorite?
Uno.
Uno? We got a new game this year called Uno Flip. It is super awesome. Have you played it before?
Yeah.
No? You should. It's a lot of fun. Well, there's also Skip Bow. That's one of my favorites. I rarely win, but I like to play. There's just different playing cards as well. Yeah. Do you have another one?
I also like Happy Salmon.
Happy Salmon. I've never played that one. So lots of games. One of my favorites is a game called Somerset. You guys ever played this?
No.
It's kind of an interesting game. It was actually created by somebody in Minden, Nebraska. And for about 20 years, the only place you could buy it was Ace Hardware in Minden, Nebraska. Now you can buy it on Amazon because you can buy anything on Amazon. But it's one of my favorite games.
Anything on Amazon,
right? Pretty close. Even a boat.
So
you never know. But one of the things I like about card games is sometimes, as much as I enjoy playing them, I don't win. But when you don't win, The game gets over, and you can start a new game. You can just start all over again. So it doesn't matter if you win or lose. When you start a new game, everybody starts at the same place. Now, my wife almost always wins at cards, but we can start a new game, and I always tell her, see, we're even at the beginning, and I like that. Today, we're going to talk about Ruth and Naomi, and there are a couple people who had to start over as well, but they didn't, like, have a card game they started over. They kind of had to start over their whole life. They had to pick up and move to a whole new place and start over. That can be kind of scary and hard. But starting over then means we can all start from the same place, and God will be with us in the midst of that. So during the sermon today, I want you guys to listen for those two names, for Ruth and Naomi, and listen about how they had to start over in their life as well, okay? Awesome. Let's have a quick prayer, and then I'll give you guys some suckers, okay? Would you repeat after me? Say, Dear Jesus, thank you for loving us. Thank you for your grace and a chance to always start over. In Jesus' name, amen. Awesome, you guys did great. Come up and get three suckers, one for you and two to give to someone else.
I heard a preacher a while back, I'm not sure when, that said, be a miracle for someone. And when I heard that, I didn't like it. I thought it was kind of cheesy. And it was probably because we usually think of miracles like this, supernatural events that go against, like, the laws of nature. You know, the ones we see in the Bible, Jesus resurrected the dead and he healed. And I think that's why I didn't like it. I didn't get it. But then he goes to explain that we can be a miracle for someone when we are the answer to their prayers. And as we're starting this new year and we're talking about new beginnings, I cannot help but to think about my new beginning, my starting over, when I moved to North Platte. It was very scary. I was very afraid of all of you. It was scary, you know. It was the move from Texas. I was scared of the weather. I was scared of just everything being different. And so the little details usually make everything a little bit more important. So I'm going to share one with you. So when we decided to move, we were packing. And, you know, moving is expensive. The church took care of us. Don't worry. But still it's expensive. And when we were packing, we decided we're not taking the kids' beds because they're not worth bringing up there all the way from Texas. They were just in really bad shape. It was time for new beds and new mattresses. So talking with people, we decided we were going to head to San Antonio, and we were going to pick up some stuff there and then head to North Platte. We get to San Antonio, and it doesn't come through. We don't find the guy that was going to sell us a couple of mattresses. And I was like, we'll be fine. We'll be fine. We'll figure it out. They're little. They can sleep on the floor. And okay, we're fine. So we get here. I think it was a Friday. We have some people to help us unload the U-Haul. And, well, a couple notices that we don't have any beds or mattresses for the kids. And I was a little embarrassed because, you know, oh my gosh, they're going to think we're going to make them sleep on the floor. I mean, we were, but I didn't want them to know. And, you know, it was no big deal. I thought, you know, slowly we'll start getting the furniture. So a week later, or the next week, I get a call from this couple. I'm not saying names because they were very discreet about it, but they're from here. And they told us, we want to buy bunk beds for your kids. And we want to also buy mattress. And we didn't ask for anything. And it was just like, Because if we had bought beds, they wouldn't have fit in the rooms. We did not know how small the rooms were. We needed bunk beds. And they provided bunk beds. They provided the mattresses. They even provided the bedding for the beds. And all that just to let me know, they responded to a need. That's what That's what they did, okay? They saw a need and they responded to it. No one had to ask them to do it. But what maybe they don't know is that when they did that, God was using them to let me know that he was taking care of me when I was freaking out. That he was there and that he would always provide when I was really afraid. So that's my invitation for you today. If you see a need that is placed in front of you, respond to it. If you feel this nudge to act, do it. You don't know when someone's feeling lonely or forgotten, and that text message lets them know that God is there. I'm not asking you to buy bunk beds. I'm not asking you to, you know, be a miracle in a way to raise the dead. No, I'm asking you to respond to the needs that are in front of you. You are welcome to give. We have the offering plate in the back, and you can also do it online. Anything you do builds the kingdom of God. Amen.
Well, thank you, Denise. We also are celebrating a milestone of sorts. Now that we are into the new year, Denise has served here longer than our last three youth ministers. So, whew. Kind of an answer to prayer for us as well, our miracle, but you still got one to beat, right? 32 months, that's the next goal, okay? Well, we also have a chance to celebrate a baptism today, so I would invite Waylon Arnsdorf and his family to come up at this time as well. And as they're coming up, I'd just like all of the other family, would you stand for just a second so we can see all of the family that's here to celebrate today as well? Thank you all. We're so glad that you're here to celebrate with us. How you doing, buddy? Are you ready? We'll see, huh? Well, brothers and sisters in Christ, it is through the sacrament of baptism that we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We're incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation, and we are given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is a gift God offers to us without price. Today, we are celebrating the baptism of Waylon Wells Arnsdorf. To the parents, I ask you, on behalf of the whole church, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, answer, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, putting your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Now to the family that is here as well, will you nurture Waylon in Christ's holy church, committing that by your teaching and example, he may be guided to accept God's grace, profess his faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, answer, we will. Now, to the church family, this congregation, we ask you, do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If so, answer, we do. Will you nurture one another in Christian faith and life and include this family now before you in your love and care? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround them with a community of love and forgiveness that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them, that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. Amen. Would you pray with me today? Loving and gracious God, we thank you so much for the many gifts that you have given us. Eternal God, through your mighty acts of salvation, we come to know you through the gift of these waters. From the moving of your Spirit over the waters of creation, the deliverance of your people through the flood in the Red Sea. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb, baptized by John, and anointed by your Spirit. Jesus called his disciples to be and make disciples of all nations through the gift of his baptism of death and resurrection. We ask you to pour out your Holy Spirit again on this gift of water and those who receive it. Wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness through their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in Christ's final victory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hi, buddy. Will you come see me? Oh, we'll turn you that way so you can see Mom. How's that? Waylon, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May you always love Jesus. Amen. And just as we did with the ancients in the Old Testament, when anyone was called to a special assignment, they were anointed with oil. We anoint you with the sign of the cross and this God who is always there for you and with you. Amen, Waylon. You want to go for a walk? We'll be right back. Church, this is Waylon. He is our newest baptized member, and we just made some promises. We're going to help him to know Jesus, that we're going to love him, that we're going to pray for him, that we're going to support him in all the days of his life, so that he may know not just the love of Jesus, but the love of the body of Christ, each of us as well. Would you clap and welcome our newest baptized member? Buddy, congratulations. Thank you all. Here's his baptism certificate as well. Congratulations.
Thank you.
See you later, buddy.
Well, we have a lot to celebrate and worship today, and one of the things that we practice here at First Church is prayer. And one of the things that I love about the way this church prays is that we often begin with praise. So with that, I invite you to think about those little miracles or unorthodox miracles that Denise was talking about. Maybe the miracle of Mr. Waylon. Man, he's got some ears on him and I love it. It's awesome. That's great for a cowboy hat, bud. That's really good. Anyway, but we'll start there with praise in our prayer time now, and I invite you to pray with me. Make yourself available in a posture of prayer. Well, Jesus, today we give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. It is so wonderful to hear the voices of little children squirming in their seats and maybe fussing a little bit. It's a sign of new life. And that's a sound of praise. So Jesus, today as we come to you in your house, we know the coos and the cries aren't necessarily praise and worship to you, but we have been challenged. We have been invited to help those sounds turn into praise, turn into worship and adoration for you. And so my prayer today, Jesus, first, is that our presence here today, and those of us even joining online today, would be honoring to you, to your kingdom, and your purpose in our lives. But Jesus, as we celebrate you, we also admit that we need you. We need you in our lives. We need your help. We need your steadfast love. Because when an unkind word is shared, when a tough situation approaches, whatever it is, Jesus, we don't always act the way we should. We don't always know how to respond. And sometimes there's just no way to respond. So Jesus, we ask for your help. Help clean our hearts. Help us in our sinful ways. But Jesus, also help us heal the world as you would have us. Jesus, we thank you for letting us be in worship here today, together. Again, we honor and praise your name, and we lift up the prayers of our hearts by praying together the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I was just reminded of that as the kids are going. To you parents, it's always worse on your anxiety than it is anybody else's. Can we just get a little amen that we love hearing kids in worship? Amen. All right. So that's also a reminder. You see a parent in church, you tell them, thank you for bringing your kid. Okay? So you all have a challenge today. Let's stand and continue in our worship. We're going to sing Where He Leads Me. I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. Take thy cross and follow, follow me. Where He leads me, I will follow. Where He me, I will follow. Where He leads me, I will follow. I'll go with Him, all the way. I'll go with Him through the garden. I'll go with Him through the garden. I'll go standing for our scripture lesson this morning.
I'll be reading from Ruth 1, 1 through 5. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to live in the country of Moab, he and his wife and two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. These took Moabite wives. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. When they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Before you sit down, let's take a minute to greet one another. Will you say hi to those you're seated by? And for those of you joining us online, we are so grateful that you've taken a moment to join us. Whether you're watching live or later, let us know that you're watching. Interact with us, prayer requests, everything in the comments. That's always helpful. Again, we are so glad you're here. Thank you for joining us.
Well, we are so thankful that everyone's in worship. As you find your way back to your seats, we're just so glad that we get to come together and worship God in this way. I've got to tell you, I'm really excited to start this new sermon series to kick off 2024. My wife is starting classes for her nursing degree on Monday. My boys are both gone, so there's lots of newness this year, but those new experiences can be amazing as well. Now, some pastors will pick a sermon series by coming up with a topic and then finding scriptures from throughout the Bible that really feed into that sermon idea. You may have noticed that I will often pick a book of the Bible or a character and really put the theme all around that. Certainly what happened with this series. Ruth is an incredible character, but honestly, an overlooked little book in the Old Testament. It's actually only 4 chapters long, and so I would encourage everyone to go home this afternoon and just read the whole book of Ruth. It'll probably take you about 20 minutes, all right? I know, only a pastor can take a 20-minute read and turn it into a 6-week series, you know? But there is so much to the story. So much more than what we see on the surface. And even though it's a story that's thousands of years old, I think it speaks so much and has so much to teach us about our lives today, especially about this idea of starting over. It's a new year, and that can be a starting over, or it can be facing a new change, a big change in life as well. Whatever it is, there are just times where we have to hit the restart button. Now, the book of Ruth is all about Ruth, but we'll also hear about another incredible character named Naomi, a woman whose life seems to be marred with tragedy. Have you ever had one of those days or weeks where it feels like everything goes wrong and you think, it can't get any worse than this, and then it does? Yeah, that was Naomi's life. Of course, Pastor Craig Rochelle says, if Ruth was turned into a movie, it would be a chick flick. He says, bad news to all you action folks, there are no shootouts, no explosions, and no car chases in this story. Instead, we've got a couple of women and a heck of a lot of talking. Out of 85 verses in this book, 55 of them are dialogue. And yet one of the reasons that I was so drawn to this story and this book is how relatable I think it is to our lives. Several commentators pointed out that this is a unique little book because there are no miracles in this book at all. No one with super strength, no healings, no angelic visits, no resurrections. And yet I wonder if part of what makes the story so meaningful to our lives is that there's nothing miraculous. I mean, the reality is most of us don't have those outrageous miracle moments, at least not on a regular basis. I have my own miracle story that I'll share at some point in worship. Don't get me wrong, I do believe that God still performs miracles. But it's not the norm. Then again, if it happened all the time, maybe it wouldn't feel very miraculous. Now, Ruth's story is, it's about the everyday. It's about life in the trenches where most of us find ourselves. Today's text starts out with the words, "In the days when the judges ruled." Now, Ruth is tucked between the Old Testament book of Judges and the Old Testament book of 1 Samuel that tells us the story of David. And it feels a little out of place, like, why in the world did we put this story in there? But it really gaps between these two books and gives us the backstory for David's family. See, there were several centuries between when the Israelite people arrived in the Promised Land and the time when the kings came to rule. And during that time, there was no central government, no rulers per se. So every once in a while, God would call these special men and women to lead, people called judges. Maybe you remember hearing about it in a Sunday school class or a Bible study. Names like Deborah, or Gideon, or Samson. Oh, Samson was one of my favorites growing up. He was like this biblical era superhero. He had this super strength, and there are stories of him going out and taking on a whole army by himself. There's a story where he takes on a lion barehanded in wind, and the little boy in me just loved it. And I'm like, this is awesome. He's one of the best characters. And then I grew up, and I started looking at his life, and I went, he's not a very good role model. Actually, twice in the book of Judges, it says everyone did what was right in their own eyes. Kind of defined the era. Now, the Israelites still had a God, still had the tabernacle. They still had the laws and the commandments that had been handed down to them. What they didn't seem to have was any sense of accountability. Everyone did what they thought was right. I don't know, sometimes I feel like that's what our society tells us as well. Everyone should just do what they think is right. But if we're honest, that's not really what we want. If we're honest, we all want people to do what we think is right, and it doesn't always work that way. But I digress. That's not the real point of this story, but it does help to set the stage. So in verse 1 it reads, "In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to live in the country of Moab, he and his wife and two sons." The story begins with this struggle. A famine probably caused by a drought. And in an effort to care for his family, Elimelech packs up his wife and his sons and literally takes off for greener pastures. I found it interesting in my study this week that Moab is really only about 50 miles from Bethlehem. Doesn't seem like it's that far away. Of course, as just about any farmer or rancher can tell you, in a drought, 50 miles one way or the other can make a huge difference in what's available. But in the midst of this situation, it feels like 50 miles. It must have been like a two-day walk for them to pack up and move to this new area, but it was probably much more difficult than that. See, this area, it was a combination of these jagged rocks and these shifting desert sands. All along the area of the Dead Sea, where the salt content really made it hard for just about anything to grow. We actually found a picture that we'll put up on the screen from the Naomi Road, as they call it. Now, I love to hike, and this might be a great hiking adventure, but I can't imagine packing up my whole family on the verge of starvation and all of our belongings and trying to travel down that road. I mean, it seemed like a logical move, a logical plan. Things weren't going well where they were at, so it was time to try something different. Maybe you can point to a time in your own life where there was a struggle and it felt like it was time to walk away and to start over. Maybe it was starting a new job or a move to a different community. Maybe it was cutting ties with a friend, deciding it's time for a divorce, or the loss of a loved one. But starting over, it comes with its own struggles. I don't know if it was God's plan for Elimelech and his family to move, but I can tell you it quickly went from bad to worse. In verse 3, it says, "But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died." And then verse 5, "Both Mahlon and Chilion also died." I mean, we read it in a few seconds. But can you imagine the amount of pain and loss Naomi must be experiencing? It sounds just so overwhelming. But then again, it kind of seems like that was par for Naomi's life. Things rarely seemed to go smooth for her. And even her sons' names point that out. I admit, I've never been much for onomastics, which is the study of people's names. I don't mean those cheesy Facebook quizzes, right? Everyone's name has a color. Click here to fill it out. Might be fun, but I'm talking about the real origins and meaning of a name. Some people love it. I've just never quite understood it all, but it can be interesting. Now, if you have a study Bible at home, you might look at this scripture, and it's going to have little footnote markers after each of these names, and it can be incredible to read that as you see more of the story. Like the name Elimelech, it literally means "my God is king." It's a great name for someone in a biblical story, but I'm not sure he's actually living that way. We never see in Scripture that he prays or that he worships or that he talks to God about it. He just does what he thinks is right. And it goes from bad to worse. And then there's Naomi, which literally means sweet or pleasant. You listen to the stories of struggle in her life and go, how she kept from being bitter and harsh is amazing. Sweet and pleasant, that's a pretty amazing name. But then you look at her sons, right? Mahlon, which literally means sick or sickly, and Chilion, that means frail or tired. I don't know, maybe they were unhealthy as babies, or maybe it was a self-fulfilling prophecy. Whatever the case may be, let me just say to any expecting parents out there, don't name your kids sick and tired, okay? You might nickname them that, but save that for home. All joking aside, you see how things just went from bad to worse. First a famine, then a challenging move, then you lose not only your husband, but your kids. And now these three women are left alone in a society that already tends to neglect and overlook women. In these five verses, it sets the stage for the rest of the story, but it kind of sounds like the beginning of a Greek tragedy. So after 10 years and more heartache than anyone deserves, Naomi makes the 50-mile journey back home. It's humbling and sometimes sobering of a reality. When everything seems to go wrong, when we feel like we don't know where to turn, there's this part of us, there's this innate sense in us that says, I just got to go home. Now, sometimes that's literally home, and sometimes it's just returning to what's familiar. I don't think I really understood that significance until I had kids of my own. How the seeds we plant matter. Because if it's familiar for our kids, maybe when life gets tough, they'll return to what they know. My youngest son is in the military right now, and he joined at age 17, turned 18 while in basic training, and it's been a little challenging for him. It's a little harder being an adult than I think he thought. I have a nephew that got a shirt for Christmas that says, "Occasional Adult," and I think Nate really wants that shirt right now. But when he got to his current base, he was really struggling. He was feeling lonely and disconnected, and the parent in me wanted to help him. We encouraged him to find a hobby or to go different places. You're in Florida, for Pete's sakes. Go and enjoy the beach, something. Just get out. And the preacher in me, it said, you know, you really should go to church because that's what we do at church. We get to know each other. But he hasn't gone in the 6 weeks he's been there. And so when Wendy and I went to visit him over Christmas, we had this great idea that we were going to take him to church, and he wouldn't go with us. That's when he decides to be the adult, right? Make the decision. So we decide we're going to watch worship, and we've got our phones out, and we're watching worship from our hotel room. And he's sitting down with us, and he's watching a little bit as the sermon's going on. But as soon as the sermon's done, Nate gets up, and he goes to the kitchen, and he starts banging around and pouring juice and making toast. And as a dad, I'm like, really? You can't even wait for worship to be done? Really? I didn't say it, but I'm thinking it really hard. And then Nate comes back, and he sits down between Wendy and I, and he takes his toast and breaks it, and he says, "Let's have communion." And I'm so glad I didn't say something stupid as a dad. how those seeds we plant matter. See, Ruth and Naomi's story, it's sometimes like our story. Maybe not as extreme as famines and losing your family, but there are times where life seems to go wrong. And we just don't know what to do. Author and pastor James Howell says, naming the piling up of loss matters, as does the surprising hope of redemption, which is a divine surprise and yet requires action, courage, pluck, and ingenuity. I mean, after these first five verses, the story completely shifts, and God is certainly present, but maybe not in the ways we would think. It's certainly no fairy tale with a fairy godmother who waves a wand and everything turns out perfect. When the situation hits rock bottom, God shows up, not in some big miracle, but in a subtle presence. In verse 6, it says, "When Naomi heard in Moab that the Lord had come to the aid of his people by providing food for them, she and her daughters-in-law prepared to return home from there." No angelic visit, no picture of the heavens opening up, but a reminder, God is still there. So these three women, they hit the road. And along the way, Naomi turns to her daughters-in-law and tells Orpah and Ruth that they should go home to their dads. See, Naomi can't provide for them, and she knows it. Eventually, Orpah goes back to her father's household, but Ruth won't. She commits to staying with Naomi no matter what. And in verse 16, we hear this incredible and iconic dedication of Ruth. She says, "Do not press me to leave you, to turn back from following you. Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. I'm with you, no matter what." I mean, what a gift. What a godsend to have someone who's got your back no matter what. Ruth doesn't go because it's the easier choice. Naomi can't provide for her, and she knows it. Instead, Ruth walks away from everything she's ever known so she can be there for her hurting mother-in-law. Starting to see why this is such a great story? Waylon is. He knows it. See, we're just scratching the surface of this story, and yet there is so much to it. Let me just point out three practical lessons from what we've covered today. Number one is the importance of planting seeds of faith. You never know when you're going to need those seeds. You never know how they're going to bring new fruit. It's like Hansel and Gretel leaving their breadcrumbs. Sometimes planting those seeds brings us back home. Or number two, look for God. Not just in the big miraculous moments, but the everyday moments of life. God is always there in the subtle signs. And number three, find who's got your back. Find those people who are always there for you. And maybe just as importantly, figure out who you can be that person for. Who needs you to be there for them. I mean, Ruth doesn't have super strength like Samson, but man, she's a bit of a superhero. Taking on all the struggles of life and saying, I'm with you. No matter what. Now, here's a warning, a little bit of a spoiler alert for you. You can plug your ears if you don't want to know the ending, but Ruth's story ends up being a happily ever after. Even better, her story creates this ripple that's seen throughout history. Some of you know what happens, but maybe you don't know all of it. As a matter of fact, I learned something new this week. That in the Talmud, a Jewish writing that we don't have in our Bible, tradition says that Orpah, her descendant, becomes a famed giant named Goliath. From the Bible, we learn Ruth's descendant is David, a shepherd boy who becomes a king. And Ruth becomes one of just four women who were named in the genealogy of Jesus. Her story, it seems so normal. And God still uses her. The thing is, if God can use her, God can use you and I as well. It doesn't have to be miraculous to be meaningful. And we don't have to be superheroes to be special. The reality is sometimes life is filled with struggles. Sometimes things seem to go from bad to worse. Sometimes we try to make sense of things and we try to do what makes sense in our own minds and it doesn't work out. Sometimes we decide we just have to walk away. And when we hit those moments, it's important to realize we planted seeds. That God is still there in the little things. And that we can cling to those people who always have our backs. When we do that, God uses our stories as well. Amen? Would you pray with me today? Loving and gracious Father, we are so thankful for all the ways that you show up, the ways that you make a difference in our lives, how you come in those subtle but meaningful ways. So as we come to the time of communion in today's service, God, we ask you to pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. that you would make them be the body and the blood of Christ, so that in some way we can become the body of Christ, the church, for all those in the world. We can be redeemed by your great love. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to the whole world, until Jesus comes in that final victory and we all feast at your heavenly banquet. We ask all of this, God, through the name of your Son, Jesus, who with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, we give all honor and glory to you, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Well, church, we come to communion not just to practice a ritual, not just to go through a standard routine, but to recognize that in those simple moments, God does the amazing. How on the night Jesus gave himself up for us, he gathered with his friends and took an ordinary loaf of bread and made it more. Lifting it up to heaven, giving thanks to God, he broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me." After the meal, Jesus took a cup, again, common and ordinary, and poured it out for his friends, lifted it up to heaven, gave thanks to God for all who would come before and all who would come after, and said, "This is the blood of a new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So we come today to this incredible, simple, everyday meal, knowing that God uses it in amazing ways. I want to invite those that are helping serve communion to come forward at this time.
Well, as our servers prepare, I'll give us a few words of instructions here. We're going to have two stations up front to receive. Our welcome team will invite us down the center aisle. And when you approach the station, just let us know that you're ready by placing your hand in the shape of a cross. You'll be handed a piece of bread, dip it lightly in the cup, and eat it. If you need a gluten-free option, just ask. We have that available. And after you've received, I invite you to kneel, to pray, to make your way around either side, back to your seats. We'll have hymns. It's a time to sing. It's a time to worship. It's a time to pray and reflect. One last note, if you need served in your pew, please let us know, and our welcome team will direct a station to you once everyone else has been served. The invitation is always simple, and it's one of the things I love the most about Ruth is she wasn't a part of the church. She wasn't an in-crowd person. So too here, we believe and we practice that you don't have to be a member of this church or any church. You don't have to be a certain age. All we ask is that you have that desire in your heart to draw closer to Jesus. I think we're ready. I'll invite Mary Lynn to begin playing and our welcome team forward. Let us continue in worship. One bread, one body, one Lord of all. Which we bless, and we, though many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one Lord. Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man, no more. One bread, one body, one Lord of all. One cup of blessing which we bless. Thank you.
many the works, one in the Lord of all, one bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we
you to stand as you are able. I'll invite our acolytes to get ready. Let's sing the first two verses of our next hymn.
To order and provide.
go from this time and place of worship, as we enter a life of worship, go with this knowledge that God is always with us. Life may not always go the way we plan, but with the church, the body of Christ, the Christ Almighty, everything can be okay. Go and share this message. Be with one another and help them to know that God is always there. And that changes everything. Thanks for worshiping today.